Asante sana, and good morning, and praise the Lord, everyone. My name is Felarmine. I see from the end of Christian Union, I'm still Muiruri, which is my official name, but God expanded my name, and now I'm Felarmine Gitonga. And I thank God for this morning, for the opportunity He's given us to share His word. I believe that you're able to see the presentation from your end.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
I also thank the coordinators for this week. Thanks a lot for giving me the opportunity. As I've said, I'm married to Eliphaz Kitonga. He's within the meeting. But because of time, and also because he has a session in the evening, I'll not give him a chance to say hi. God has blessed us with two lives to nurture, Joy, who is 11, and Manuel, who is 5. And we praise the Lord for that. We fellowship at a church in Tharaka-Nithi County called Gospel Across the Nations, where I support him to pastor. But we work in Nairobi. So this morning, we are looking at the art of persuasion, and we are still basing our discussion from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, from verse 11 onwards. But for this discussion of today, our main verse is verse 11, but allow me to start from verse 8 so that you're able to look at it from the context. So the Bible says that you are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please Him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. Then verse 10, it says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us and for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. Then the core verse, since then we know what it is to fear the Lord, we try to persuade others. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it is also plain to your conscience. The New King James Version and the King James Version, they replace the word fear with terror. And this is a verse that is usually very dear to my heart. It is what I put on my WhatsApp profile. I even wondered whether the coordinators had perused through my status to see it. But we thank God for it. I know we are all from CHS. At one point or another, we must have used problem-based learning or have heard of it. And what we are doing is for everything we are reading, we are looking for the keyword. So as we proceed, we'll be using the word like confidence, all receiving something or a reward. We'll focus a bit on Christ, and we'll also be looking at the conscience of people. So to start with, let us look at what it is to persuade, so that we are able to read from the same script and we can understand each other as we move along. I thank the moderator for praying for me. So we'll just go on, and we know that the Lord is with us and the Holy Spirit is guiding us. So to persuade is actually to make someone to do something or to believe in something, and to do that by giving them a good reason to do it. So when we look at that, it means that persuasion entails some form of communication. We cannot persuade without communicating with that person, because you have to give him or her a good reason to believe or to do what we intend them to do. So in this work of persuading people, our main goal as believers and as people who belong to the kingdom of God, we want to persuade people to become subjects of our King, who is Jesus, our subject of our kingdom. And therefore, from this definition, as we persuade people, we need to remember we can make the subjects to actually believe or to do the things of our kingdom based on good reasons. And that should be our target of our persuasion. But also we need to be careful, because you can also make them to be subjects for the wrong reasons. For example, we may make them to be subject to the kingdom because they want a challenge-free life. Like we can present in our persuasion, we can present that when you come to Christ, maisha ni tabarare, or also we can also like push them because of fear to the kingdom, where they are coming to the kingdom because of fear. And that should not be our intention for the persuasion. It should be to give them a very good reason, because when they do that, they'll be like the seeds Christ talked about in the parable of the sower, whose the word was laid in the fertile place, which are prepared hearts, and they'll bring forth fruit. But if we make them to come to the kingdom for the wrong reasons, then they may be like the ones who never understood it, and therefore they don't remain in the kingdom. They can come and leave. So we also need to ensure that no one fails to come to the kingdom because you have not either persuaded them or because you have not given them a good reason to do that. And therefore, seeing that we can persuade and not be effective, then we need the art of persuasion. And the art means that we need to have some special skills to be able to do something. And in our context here, it actually means being able to persuade people and they come to be part of our kingdom for the right and the good reasons. So skills are not born with somebody. We are all born in sociology. We say that there's no one who is born with skills, knowledge, etc. We acquire them through teaching in the normal issues of this world, but we thank God that spiritual things are both learned, but they are also imparted. And I pray that as we continue to share, that the Holy Spirit may teach us, and also it may impact in us this art of persuasion. I know we are all at different stages of persuasion, and I believe that all of us, in whichever stage we are in, of learning the skills of persuasion, that the Holy Spirit will help us to move to the next level. So I want us to start by noting that persuasion is a very key kingdom principle. Because even in line with the theme of this week, that we have been called to bring others to reconciliation with our King, and who is the creator of this world. But that one cannot be achieved if we don't have this art of persuasion. We will not make them be reconciled if we don't give them a good reason to do that, and we do that effectively. But even after they come to Christ and they come to be part of our kingdom, we need still to use the same skill so that they can be transformed. We need to give them good reasons why they need to leave their old nature, as you have been discussing, why they need to adopt the new nature in Christ. And that can only be achieved through persuasion. If then we don't have this art of persuasion, it means you'll fail in our main mandate of making disciples, as Christ told us in Matthew 28:19. And when we look at Jesus himself, when we look at the apostles, when we look at the Holy Spirit, this is a mechanism that the Holy Spirit still uses. It is the same mechanism that Jesus used and the apostles. We don't see them using force. We don't see them coercing or maybe not using the truth. And this actually makes the distinction between the God we worship and other small false gods that exist in the world. Christianity cannot be propelled forward by force. We cannot use guns. We cannot use bombs. We just have to learn the art of persuasion so that we can be in line with our foundation, which is Jesus and the apostles. But also really reflects the character of God, that our God is a gentle God. He doesn't force his way. When you look at Deuteronomy verse 30, and chapter 30 and verse 19, you find that God is saying that he has laid before us life and death, and we have to make a choice. In 1 Kings 22 and verse 20, I'm very amazed that God seated in heaven, he asks, who will I send to persuade Ahab? He fronts it. He doesn't pick someone and tells him or her, I am sending you. He's just floating. That means that our God does not use force, but he persuades. In Isaiah 6:8, this is where he was asking who will send to as a savior of the world. Even Jesus was not forced to come. He was persuaded, and it was a request that was just made to him. So we need to see that persuasion is core, because it is actually the main principle of building our kingdom and even achieving the kingdom objectives. Just a moment. The slides are hanging. Need to share again. So for some reason the slides are not moving, so I'll use it when it is not in slide share, so that I am able to move them. Sorry for that. So now that we have seen that the art of persuasion is a core for our kingdom, we need then to ask ourselves, for us to be able to do it effectively, what do we need? When we are like drawing something in art, there are things that we must have. Like you must have maybe a piece of paper or a canvas, or some paint or a pen. So we have already seen that the art is a skill, and we need to be efficient. Then we need to remember that there are things that we must put in place, and the first one is that you need to be efficient persuaders. We need to have the right message, and we have to have efficient methods. So we'll expound on this a bit, then we finish. So we start by looking at us as efficient persuaders, and for us to be able to persuade efficiently, and efficiently I mean we achieve our outcomes, but you also do it with the minimum resources in terms of time, in terms of even monetary resources, but also in terms of spiritual resources. So we need the first thing to be persuaded. That means you should have been persuaded and become subjects of this kingdom. We cannot be able to effectively and efficiently reach out to others to join and persuade them to join if ourselves we are not yet persuaded. So we should be subjects. And when we become subjects of the kingdom, we are able to experience and to understand the kingdom. And it can be quite hard for someone who is not part of this kingdom to try and persuade others to join. You remember the sons of Sceva? We need to really understand the principles, like that even when we introduce ourselves like Paul was doing, with a lot of confidence, as Jesus was doing, was very confident, was saying that the things that I speak to you are the things that I've seen and the things that I've heard. So we may not be very confident if we don't understand the kingdom and if we have not experienced it. And that experience and understanding can only occur when we are at the center of this kingdom. Besides being persuaded to join the kingdom as subjects, we also need to be persuaded to understand that we have also been called to be persuaders. And I think we have looked at that extensively as ambassadors, living like Christ. We have been informed this week, and I think the Holy Spirit has really been speaking in the same line, that for sure we have been called to be persuaders. I remember my husband one time told me that he started preaching and being a persuader before he actually got saved for some several years. But when he compares the results then and the results after he became a subject of the kingdom, the results are quite different. So we need actually to ensure that we really understand our kingdom, and we also pray and seek for experience of this kingdom, so that as we share it from a point of understanding, and that will give us a lot of confidence confidence. Well, I know you all have been in school for health sciences. We cannot just teach students theory, and we also not taught theory. Sorry, I didn't say I'm also a lecturer. So when I teach the students in class, I also take them to the clinical areas for experience, and that makes them to be better nurses. So even in this kingdom, we need to be part of it and square in it so that you're able to persuade others with confidence. Then the other thing that we need is that we should be powered by the Holy Spirit and guided by the Holy Spirit. If we become persuaders with ourselves, just our experience and our understanding, and using our words only, will not be very effective. We'll be like wood without fire. So we'll have brought all the wood, the good words, the good stories about our experience, but we may not achieve much. So we really need to ensure that we are powered and guided by the Holy Spirit. And I noted that it's actually possible for someone to be in the kingdom. They are born again, but and they are part of the kingdom, but they have not actually received the Holy Spirit. So we need to endeavor, like the church that was in Ephesus, when Paul visited them, and I told them about the Holy Spirit. They said they have even never heard of it, and actually they were true believers. So as believers, we need to seek and pray that the Holy Spirit may fill us, and that he may also guide us. If you look at the apostles before Acts 2, they actually had not won any soul, but after Acts 2, meaning after Pentecost, within a few minutes, with just a simple message from Peter, if you look at what Peter preached with the help of the Holy Spirit, he was able to persuade very many people within some few minutes. But also when you look at Paul, in most of his letters, he has really repeated that he didn't go to them with just plain words or fancy words, but he went to the Spirit's power. So for us to be able to be effective in our persuasion, besides being subjects of this kingdom, we also need to really be guided and powered by the Holy Spirit. In the guidance of the Holy Spirit, sometimes he can send us to some people. You remember the case of Paul, there is a place he was going to preach, but the Holy Spirit told him otherwise. So it is very critical for us to be able to be guided by the Holy Spirit. Sometimes I get challenged by Jesus when he came on earth. His focus of persuasion was actually on the Jews, and he knew very well, as guided by the Holy Spirit. That's why even the Phoenician woman, when she came to ask for healing, he said that the food is for children, not for dogs, because he actually understood his mission, and that can only come by the Holy Spirit. So if you don't, if we persuade without the Holy Spirit, we may find ourselves actually farming in the wrong part of the vineyard, but the Holy Spirit is able to guide us well. Then the other element that we need to be efficient persuaders is being intentional about it. And I think this is a big challenge to the church of today. We should avoid making persuasion to be what we call the standalone services or vertical services. Like you see, when we go to MCH, immunization is part of MCH services. Suppose it was positioned in one corner, the utilization would be less. So we should also use the same model of persuasion as Christians, where we make persuasion to be part of our life. Our lives, you know, sometimes we divide our lives a lot as believers, where we have the sacred parts activities, then we have secular activities. But I don't believe in the life of a subject of the kingdom has a secular life. Even as we work, like when I'm working as a lecturer, when you're working as a clinician, when you're working in a program, in an NGO, that work is not secular. That work should contribute to the kingdom. And for us to be intentional about persuasion, then we need to ensure that persuasion is one of the objectives. You know, it is not the only objective of doing what you do in a daily life, but it should be the constant objective. If you are a lecturer, when you are preparing the slides, you need to ensure you have already pre-thought, where can I introduce our kingdom in these slides? As a clinician, if you are clerking or you are taking care of a patient, you need to be pre-thinking. Today, as I manage the patients, how will I introduce or how will I communicate our kingdom in this agenda? I just give an example. When I'm teaching, I teach biostatistics and I also teach gynecology. So when I'm teaching probability in biostatistics, I have to introduce that because we say that the probability of something we are sure will happen is one. So I introduce that the probability of all of us dying is one. Then I introduce that the probability of what God has said happening is one. You see, you are giving examples. If I'm teaching about bleeding disorders in gynecology, the example I'll give is the example of the woman who had a bleeding disorder who was healed by Christ. So I've already communicated the message for our kingdom. So we need to ask ourselves in integrating the persuasion message. If someone comes to your house and even without a word and leaves, will that person leave knowing that you are Christian? If a person enters your car, will they leave knowing that there is a kingdom of God? If someone looks at your Facebook page and the other social media, are we really communicating? And I've seen that people who sell other ideologies in this world, they really brand that ideology in everything that they do. That's an area that I think as believers, we really need to trust God that he may build us and actually make us effective persuaders, such that we brand our lives with the kingdom. Sometimes when you enter some public transport, when you use them, you find that before you leave, you'll actually know which part of the kingdom or which kingdom that driver or the conductor subscribes to. So we need to ensure that all about us has a message of our kingdom. Then the other thing we need to remember is that you need to remove dissuaders from our lives. And that one you do at all costs, like Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9 and 22, such that we remove sin, which is the main dissuaders, but you also look at some things that may make our message not to be accepted, that you'll fail in our communication. Some of them may not be necessarily seen. Like sometimes there are posts we cannot post on the Facebook. Not that they are seen, but there is a way we post them and we lose some of our audience in relation to persuading them for the kingdom. It means that even dressing, this of course depends with the cultural places, but there are places you may need to go and change the way we dress so that we can be able to persuade. There are places we even change, even sometimes the food we eat, even sometimes our hairstyles, and it doesn't mean that they are seen in themselves. But when you find something of whichever nature says that thing we are supposed to do is not seen, then we should be able to do it so that we persuade. And that's what you need to remember, is that when we do all that, as the Bible says, and we have seen in the verses we have read, God will actually reward us. So then as I finish, I'll not explain this so much, that we should have the right message. That's a second element. Besides us being persuaders, then we should have the right message. And the right message, we always need to remember, we should major on the majors, so that we use our spiritual and physical resources. Time is never enough, so that we major on what is really called to the kingdom. When you look at Romans 14, Paul explains about eating meat or not eating meat. That's not a big issue. But we can really dwell on things that are not core to the kingdom, and we persuade people in that line unless we neglect the things that are core. If you look at Apollos, when he preached about baptism, and he preached it not in the right way, when Priscilla and Aquila came, they didn't focus only on the baptism. They understood Apollos was a believer. So we should avoid trying to persuade people, maybe because of the denomination they go to, and try now to bring them to our denomination. We need to differentiate church traditions and the core message of the kingdom so that you're able to win them. And the example I give of Paul in the Ephesus. So besides measuring on the measures, we also need to ensure that our message is right in terms of accuracy or comprehensiveness, so that we base it on the scripture, because that is the only thing that you root the people we persuade to our kingdom to be able to stand. And that means you have to bring out the sovereignty of God. And we also bring the love and also the justice of God. When you look at John 13 and verse 16, and you start from verse 14, you'll actually see that God shows his love for this world. For so God loved this world, he gave. But that so means there's something else just before that verse, which actually shows us that there's something God has done in connection to that love that the world should be able to accept, which is basically Christ. So the world needs to accept Christ. But you also need to remind them, if they don't accept that Christ, God is God of love and he's also God of justice. That if we fail, just like Israelites who never looked at the serpent, they actually died. So we need to show both sides, such that we don't just show the justice of God or just concentrate on the love of God. We have to bring it and also make them understand that the fact that God loves us cannot mean that he will not punish those who are not subjects to his kingdom. Just like judges can throw someone to court, and that one doesn't make them hate us. They still have love. Then we need to use the efficient methods, like ensure that we are specific to our audience. We can learn from Paul. When he was speaking to the Jews, he addressed them differently than the ones when he went to the Gentiles. Like you remember in Athens, he started by mentioning their gods. In Jews, you talk about the patriarchs. So when we are dealing with those ones who are already in faith and persuading them, we have to use different methods that are effective for them. And when you use the methods, we need to ensure we mix them, that our words to the people and also our word to God through prayer. Then we need also to use the deeds, such that we don't speak, then our deeds, our behaviors speak differently, as I said earlier. And also we need to remember what Jesus, the apostles, used the works, meaning like the gifts of the Holy Spirit. When we utilize them, they actually make our method more efficient. But we should not just focus on words, forget the deeds, forget the works. We need to bring all of them. Then we need to consider the channels, and especially nowadays, there are so many channels that we can use, the social media. But you need to ask ourselves the appropriate channel for our audience, such that when you're on social media, we know it's the young generation we want to reach. We should not be fixated, like thinking we still have to do crusades. Like sometimes you find someone in Nairobi town doing a crusade and maybe the audience is lost. So we need to consider that. And as I finish, I need we remember that this art of persuasion has an expiry date, and we need to do it in good time so that you are not like the rich man and the Lazarus, who didn't persuade and they wanted to set people after they are long gone to persuade others. The time is now, and we need to ask ourselves whether we are actually being heard. And if not, we need to start being heard. So God bless you and have a lovely day. I hand it over to the moderator.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Madam Felarmine Muiruri, for the word. I have surely learned a lot, and it has been encouraging to me to know how God wants me to be at the workplace, how he expects of me, even when I'm meeting friends or when I've gone for a social meeting that is not really spiritual, but in that context, how he would expect me to behave, and what tools I need to have. I don't know if there's anyone who'd like to share what they have learned or comment on it. I would give at least one chance, then we can close the session. So I invite anyone willing to share something or to say what they have learned.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
This is Sylvia here. I just want to thank Felarmine for a very powerful message. And I think one of the things that come out quite clearly is the fact that we should take advantage of every opportunity to persuade people unto Christ. And even, the comment she made around what we are posting out on our social media pages. And I realized that Christians are very scared of saying that they are born again on their social media pages, and even just speaking about Christ. And we have a lot of noisy information out there on social media. And we need to try and also ensure that we are also sharing Christ on some of these platforms so that people can be able to see Christ and be able to get convicted. I remember there's a time I was also just thinking around, how we celebrate a lot of other events and we forget to celebrate one of the most important events that happen in our lives as Christians. And yet that is what speaks to people, the days we get born again. And we have all these anniversaries, we keep posting wedding anniversaries, happy birthdays. But I'm yet to see somebody talking about their born again birthday on social media and saying that now I am 10 years since I got born again. Because I think as Christians, being born again is the most important thing in our lives, but we don't talk about it. So I think it's really, a good insight, a good inspiration. Thanks so much, Felarmine, for that powerful message. And for me, I learned that I need not to be scared of persuading people on any other platform I have. And maybe I'll also start celebrating the date that I got born again as my new birthday on the social media.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sister Sylvia. One more chance for one person. If there's anyone.